Yellow Home
with Ella Schofield
and Big Hass.
I'm alive right through till 8 o'clock tonight. It's 21 minutes past five. SAG, weird word, but a big word. It basically means the Screen Actors Guild. It's the union for actors in America. Everyone needs to be a member of the Screen Actors Guild, and it's called SAG for short. Every year they have an award ceremony, and it kind of is a precursor to the Oscars. So whoever wins at the SAG Awards, normally it follows suit in the Oscars.
Yeah, that's interesting. Tell me more about it. I mean, all I'm just reading is obviously it's celebrating 27 years history. They obviously went recorded virtual because
they went completely virtual.
The situation. Chadwick Boseman, may his soul rest in peace, passed away of colon cancer at 43 last year, was honored as best lead actor in the film Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. His co-star Viola Davis won best lead actress for the same film. And then obviously The Crown apparently won the Ensemble in a Drama Series prize.
Did it? Okay,
with Gillian Anderson selected as the best female actress for her portrayal of Margaret Thatcher.
Yeah.
Margaret Thatcher.
Well, that's just ridiculous.
Thatcher.
I didn't really like her portrayal of Margaret Thatcher. An American shouldn't have been playing Margaret Thatcher. Mm. And I'm quite offended that they decided because she's American they're going to include her in such a prestigious award. I don't agree with that. I think it's really offensive. Anyway, it's what it is. I think in other countries they would never have stood for that. But I think as Brits we have to go, oh, no, it's fine. We'll have an American playing us. You know, I don't think it's good. Anyway, I'll stop moaning. Sacha Baron Cohen was also awarded, as was Michael Keaton and Frank Langella. They all gathered virtually to accept their Chicago 7 prizes. I haven't seen that, have you?
No.
Oh, I don't know.
In one of the more emotional moments of the night, 73-year-old South Korean actress Young Yo Jong won Best Female Actor for her part in the family drama Minara. 73-year-old. It's nice to win something when you're 73-year-old.
Yeah.
Her fellow nominees Olivia Colman and Glenn Close were visibly delighted when she won. And she actually said, "I don't know how to describe my feelings. I am being recognized by Westerns." Wow. Aww. I really know what she means, though.
Yeah.
It's interesting, especially like I think I was talking to you about this off air yesterday.
You were.
And it's just apparently Mark Ruffalo won Male Actor in a Television Movie, I think this is what I'm getting so far. But you know, these awards, I don't know if they really mean something anymore, to be honest. Like, it's becoming very repetitive, and I'm talking about the idea of it. It still means something for everyone. But I'm like, every year we go on and we recognize and we give. And I think that's the important part of it, to recognize.
Yeah,
don't get me wrong.
Imagine.
Like, it's just cool to recognize. But I don't know, like, does it really add value to that? Like, for example, there are many, and this is something that's been going and trending right now. Many people who are incredible legends have never won an Oscar. And there's a list of them. And
yes,
you go like,
but
how,
if you go
come,
delve
you know?
Into it, it's because they were up against even bigger legends at the time. So remember, timing is everything.
Yeah, but
so
like,
if
just
you come
Google
along
it.
At the right time, you might be more likely to win. I know what you're saying. There are some that just the timing has been off. Maybe someone else was better that particular year, even though they are historic.
Yeah,
it has to be held against who they were up against.
I'm with you. But like when you see like I'm just like. Samuel L. Jackson goes winning against anyone. I don't care. Like, I don't care. Who? Like, why would you vote against or whatever? Or how come you don't, like, you know?
Because there was obviously a better film at the time.
Ed Norton is one of the most underrated actors ever, and he has never won something, you know? I just think technically this is something that a lot of people have been talking about. So and there's a list going on. Will Smith is at the top of this list. Samuel L. Jackson, Glenn Close, come on.
I know.
So who possibly can she be running to? It's not about timing, fam. It's just...
No, it is about timing. So like, imagine three amazing films come out at the same time. The Godfather, you know, I'm trying to think, Black Thingy. I'm trying to think of some amazing movies, and they're all together. Now, you could have three absolute, impeccable, premium, sterling actors. One of them can win. So, therefore, the timing is off. they all deserve to.
Yeah, but
and
it's
definitely,
like,
Glenn Close has come out and said that. She's just like,
I don't know if she said that, but I would disagree with what she's saying, because like, I think it's when you have all these stars, you know, all these stars that have never won an Oscar before, you go like, wow, even Sir Ian McKellen.
Yeah.
How come, you know, he like, the quotes are like, he should win one for every movie he's in. Facts. and you still go on, and the list is so big and it's so huge, and it's just, it is, I don't know.
And
I think
that's what makes the awards special, though.
But it's still the corruption element of it, though. Like, it is,
not with Glenn Close, surely.
No. Incredible. I'm not saying anything about racism. It's the corruption against, like, the whole machine situation. Like,
yeah,
it is.
No, I wasn't
the whole,
meaning racist.
Yeah, the whole idea is corrupted. And how do you win? What do you win? Like, how come someone like Glenn Close, who's been acting, like, what you're saying is, like, it's a timing thing where people the film, she's up against, who's, like, that's what I'm saying, who can compete with Glenn Close?
Well, lots of people can. You could have all of those people you've just mentioned all in the same category, okay? So say you've got five amazing. But the thing is, Glenn Close isn't up for an Oscar nomination every single year. So probably she's been nominated three or four times or five times or whatever it is.
That.
Right, yeah, you can research it. So she's been nominated a certain amount of times, and just maybe that year was a really good year for films. Like, and that's what they do say, is that it's a crime that she hasn't won, but I don't think it's anything against her, because I think she's industry-liked. So I think it's just bad timing.
I think
she deserves an honor award.
See, the thing is, when you compare it like to basketball, like Michael Jordan took him 7-8 years to win. This is not the same, though, because with Glenn Close, she's done so many great movies. You're telling me that none of these movies, not one of them, has made her win one Oscar. Which I find very hard
apparently
to believe.
Apparently not,
which is hard to believe.
Yeah.
Like, you know, even with Will Smith, like, if you watch The Pursuit of Happiness, this is one of the most incredible, and he's the top of the list. He's never won an Oscar.
Yeah,
Samuel L. Jackson, like, come on, L. Jackson. Like, for me, I don't know. It's something worth talking about, and I'm going to actually do a research and see these people, who were they up to, and I'm going to come right back.
Yellow Home.
With Anna Schofield and Big
Hass. And we're live through till 8 o'clock tonight. Anna and Hass at your service. Drive safe. Be cool. Let's talk about rapid twice-weekly coronavirus tests. This is something that's going to be trialled in the UK so that people can go out, be free, do their thing. I don't think be free as in don't social distance and mask, but the UK is a rule unto itself anyway. I think once people come out, they'll come out. So what they're going to do is they're delivering boxes of these rapid tests, seven in a box. You can get them from your local pharmacy. So they're just delivered to your home and you start testing at home.
Yeah, I mean, self-testing for coronavirus could soon become the norm in the UK. That's what they're saying. And all adults are actually encouraged to test themselves for the virus twice a week. According to a report published by The Time. And you know, the whole thing is under the whole play their part kind of situation. You play your part, and I don't know. I think how effective is this test? Maybe you test yourself wrong, or you test, I don't know, like, maybe you test positive, and then you don't tell anyone.
Yeah.
I don't know how, is there a mechanism for it? Is there, you know,
you
have to trust everybody, and I don't trust everybody. I definitely don't trust that, giving to people, and then maybe they're positive or negative, or maybe even, because a lot of manipulations happen, and maybe even they test negative, but they want to be tested positive so that they be outside. I don't know, like, not to get in contact with anyone.
I agree. You know? I think it's a dodgy. Do you know what really struck me, though, during the whole thing? You know, we've been looked after so well here. 67 million versus 10 million in the UAE. We don't even have the space in the UK to put up some of the COVID testing centres that they have put up here in the UAE. So they've managed to find space, and these huge tents go up, and these huge kind of labs go up, and boom, and we're all queuing, and then they handle all the traffic. And if you think about what has happened in the last year, it's nothing short of incredible. But the UAE does have the space, it does have the means, it has the finances, so it can do all that. We honestly, Hass, in London, there isn't a square foot that isn't unaccounted for. Unless they put them in parks, and there aren't many parks in London, there's nowhere for a COVID test center to go.
I get you.
So
I think
let alone handle the traffic that would be driving.
It's a bit unfair as well to compare. I think like 67 million, 10
it's
million.
Tricky, right?
Yeah. But they're saying, I'm trying to see the benefits of testing positive. They say it takes roughly 4 or 5 days for someone infected with the virus to infect another person, which means contact tracing must identify and reach contacts as soon as possible.
Right.
But many people don't get a test until at least 24 to 48 hours after developing symptoms. And PCR tests can take more than 48 hours to return. This leaves quite the gap for transmission to occur.
Right.
So technically speaking, it could have, you know, benefits to it, and you can just, you know, self-test.
Yeah.
The aim of this rapid testing, they're saying, is to uncover cases of the virus in the community and break any chains of transmission, stopping outbreaks before they occur and picking up cases much quicker. So they can fill the gap in access to testing and kind of leave the pressure from people analyzing the PCR test.
And we have I think we went through it, Hass. Do you remember? I came in and did the show, and I was nervous because halfway through the show, I started to get a bit snivelly, and I was thinking, do I leave halfway through the show? I mean, I'm sitting here with you, and I remember having that dilemma of, but the Brit in me, we work through illness. That's what we're taught to do. We go into work with colds, we go into work with flu. But it's a whole cultural thing.
Telling
people to go, oh, I've got a bit of a headache or I've got the sniffs, stay at home. Brits won't do that. We won't do that. We're taught to, in fact, it's frowned upon if you take a day off for being ill. It's the same as if you say, my child has something. Yeah.
Frowned upon.
How many times have you noticed that if I'm feeling ill, like I'll still come in?
It's the other way around. I think, I don't know. Look, I'm going to challenge you in this one. It's also it's irresponsible. If you're ill.
Completely agree.
And you come through.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not talking about a headache ill. Like, that's not, I don't know. That's not ill.
No, but with flu or colds or things like that, you pass it on to the whole office.
Yeah.
So
you come through right here, yes, you're incredible, amazing. But the whole team will get infected.
Yep. No, you're right. But the Brit in me, talk to any British person. You know, talk to Abdul Karim.
Yo, if you're a British person, call me. Because I don't think that. Call me right now. 4215. If you're from Britain.
Yeah.
Do you agree with what Anna says? Would you come in when you're sick? Really?
Yeah, we do.
And infect everybody.
We take drugs. We'll take the paracetamol. We take the Brufen. We're like, no. And we'll struggle in. And we are respected for doing that. The people who stay at home because they're ill, they're taking the mickey out of, you know, it's all really, they call them sick notes.
Do you think it's fair? Like, just,
no,
I'm talking to you right now.
No, it's not. And like, you're completely right. We are brought up like that.
Yeah, that's funny. The rapid tests are actually designed not to work alone as well. They're saying to be implemented along the measures of social distancing, wearing face masks, hand hygiene, which is something we talk about a lot, vaccination, and of course the PCR test for those with symptoms. So if you don't have a symptom, like the cool thing with that is that you take the test and you just make sure you're cool if you have anything, and you keep doing it twice a week just to make sure that you're
stay
cool.
Stay on top of it.
Yeah, I just don't know if people are going to be really honest about it. That's my main concern, which is interesting.
I think a lot of people will, but there'll be a large chunk that won't. And so, but what, even if half of people do that, they'll be better off than they are before.
Yeah.
So the government will be looking at it, playing the numbers game.
I mean, it's a numbers game.
50%. Yeah, you're so right. If 50% carry on testing themselves every 3.5 days, we're going to have 50% of the population completely staying on top of it. And anyone who suddenly tests positive, even though they're not showing any symptoms, stays at home. And like they said, they cut the chain. So actually, it's quite a good way. Even at 50%, they'll be winning.
Yeah. One more thing, although, like, to carry out these tests, you're relying on people without any training to conduct their own tests. So the WHO recommends rapid tests should be conducted by trained operators, and I don't know how affordable or cool that is to send everybody. So home testing requires extremely clear instructions, and more guidance should be provided to make it as simple as possible without reducing this accuracy. So I think, and of course, they're not going to send a trainee with everybody that gets a home testing.
Can you imagine?
You know, like, it's just, I think it's very interesting, but let us know. I'm now more interested about the cultural topic that we spoke about right now. If a British person is sick, apparently, they're frowned on upon if you go to work. I want to get into that.
If you stay at home, you're in trouble.
Because, you know, it's the other way around in the region.
Yeah.
You're frowned upon for coming if you're sick, and you're looked down upon.
Right. You see, it still goes against the grain. for me. The other thing we can't do is, of course,
say our
children.
It depends what kind of sickness. Again, if you're like very having flu and, you know, if it's something contagious, you know, not sick, like,
oh,
you know.
Oh, flus, yeah. You take a day off for having flu in the UK. Oh, everyone thinks you're a weakling. An idiot.
I'm telling you, it's the other way around with that. But that's the beauty of the show. It's way opposite. And I would love to get, you know, an Arab person and a British person in this case, like just to, you know. Just
I
to
don't agree with it, by the way. You're right. And
no,
the Arabs
I'm just
are
saying,
right.
You're
no,
saying
no.
The Brit in me. So I'm like, okay, the Arab in me.
You know when you're brought up with something, though,
yeah.
And you know it's stupid and wrong, but you try and shake it. But I can't. I just.
It's just culture, man. I love it.
Yalla Home with Ella Schofield and Big Hass.
Music's greatest songs. Greatest songs. Worth covering. Original classic hitmakers.
All right, let's do it. Adele is a monster. She's gargantuan. Incredible. An incredible kind of rise to fame. She didn't even want to be a singer. Did you know that? Let me take you through the early life of Adele and up to where she is now. If I actually was thorough with this, we could do a three-hour show just on Adele with no music in it. So I'm going to jump from years to years and skimp through. I think the early bit's the most interesting bit because it's probably the bit we don't know. I feel like we know the latter half of Adele. But let's go right back. She was born in 1988 on the 5th of May, and her proper name is Adele Laurie Blue Adkins. Amazing. English, obviously, graduated from the Brit School in 2006, which is in Croydon, which is in South London, and I'm from South London. And when you're from South London, you can say it like that, which would be S-O-U-F-F. If you were saying it phonetically. She signed a recording contract with XL Recordings. I'm going to tell you the story of that, because that was in 2006. Just amazing that she didn't even think she would be a singer. I find that completely compelling. She's won Brit Awards, Choice Awards, BBC Sound Award in 2008. She won a poll. I mean, the whole nine yards. Her albums are ridiculous. She released her second studio album. She had a first one. Then she released her second studio album, which was called 21, 2011. The album was critically received, and just the success was phenomenal. So if you think the first one went 8 times platinum in the UK, triple platinum in the US, and contains her first song, which was Hometown Glory, which is written about Norwood, which is just next to Brixton in London. That cracks me up. West Norwood, that's where she was from. And then she did an appearance on Saturday Night Live, and that just made her massive in the US. That was a real kick. Then she did 21, and again, massive, numerous downloads, everyone loving it. 6 Grammy Awards, Album of the Year, Brit Award for British Album of the Year, American Music Award for Favourite Pop Rock Album, 17 times platinum in the UK, and the second best-selling album in the nation. In the US, that album holds the top position, or held the top position, longer than any other album since 1985. It was certified diamond, and it was the world's best-selling album of 2011 and 2012. She sold over 31 million copies of the album 21, and it is the best-selling album of the 21st century. So the success of that earned her, you can imagine, all sorts of mentions in the Guinness Book of Records. She was the first female in history on the Billboard Hot 100 to have three simultaneous top 10 singles, and that was Rolling in the Deep, Someone Like You, and Set Fire to the Rain. And of course, then in 2012, she did Skyfall. She co-wrote that. That was the James Bond film kind of song. It won an Academy Award. It won a Golden Globe. And she won the Brit Award for Best Single of the Year. She literally has just won everything. Her sales exceed 120 million records. And she is, to date, one of the world's best-selling music artists. She has 15 Grammys, 9 Brits, 3 Billboard nominations, an Ivor Novello Award for songwriting. She was named the British Academy of Songwriters number one writer. What else has she got? Just so I get it all. Oh, and she's won the 500 Greatest Albums of All Time. There you go. Let's talk about Adele. So she's 2 years old. Her dad leaves. And then it's just her and her mum. So her mum moves her to Tottenham. They go to Tottenham and they stay there for a bit. Parts of Tottenham, quite hard to live in. They then moved to Brixton, Again, I lived in Brixton for 10 years. Best time of my life. Would I want to grow up there? I'm not really sure. Then they moved over to West Norwood, which is just outside Brixton. And that's where she feels her living went down. So her first song, Hometown Glory, is about West Norwood, which is so funny. It's one of those places that doesn't do anything. It doesn't say anything, West Norwood. It just kind of is. But she was a singer. I mean, this woman could sing. She names the Spice Girls as one of her biggest influences. And she said her favourite Spice Girl was Jerry Halliwell. But one of her big things was at dinner parties was to stand up and do impressions of them, because obviously she could sing probably better than any of them. And she would do all their songs. And she used to do Jerry Halliwell really, really well and have fun with that. And then when they broke up, she was absolutely devastated. She goes on to say that they defined her as a teen. It was a really big deal. She absolutely loved them. And then went on to kind of copy it. But she went to the Brit School, which is very well renowned. She was in the same class as Leona Lewis and the same class as Jessie J. Imagine that class. You've got Adele, Jessie J and Leona Lewis all in the same class at Brit School in Croydon. And Croydon, again, is South London. And again, Croydon being named now as one of these places where incredible talent is coming out. It's really good. It's really good that these places are getting recognition, because there's all sorts of talent in that part of London. She comes out of school. Now, as she's getting to the end of her time at the school, the Brit School, she said she actually just wanted to go into A&R. She wanted to make other people's careers. She wanted to form them. But she'd written four songs and she gave them to a friend of hers, and her friend put them on MySpace. And within a few days, it had just got loads of attention everywhere. And then this guy called Richard calls her and says, I want a meeting. And he says he's from XL Records. And Adele says she only knew of Virgin Records, so she didn't believe that he was a real thing. And so she took her mate along. And Adele she tells it like it is. She's very funny. And she was like, yeah, I took my mate along because I didn't believe that it was a real thing. They go into the meeting. He immediately offers her a record deal. And he named a certain writer. And at that point, she went, oh, okay, this is real, because I love him. And at that point, she signed. She signed with them. And then the rest, of course, is history. Her albums just have shot her to fame. Absolutely amazing. When she talks about her influences, obviously, the Spice Girls are dominant. But also, she has the Cranberries in there, Sinead O'Connor, Bob Marley, The Cure, Dusty Springfield, and Annie Lennox. So quite a wide-ranging sort of spectrum of influences. But she never believed that really it would be singing that would make her career. She thought she was going to endorse other people's. They call her voice a mezzo-soprano with a range that spans from B to C, but B2 to C6. I have no idea. Now, apparently, Classic FM in London, I used to do lots of voiceovers today, Classic FM in London says she's most mistaken for a contralto all the time due to the application of a tense chest mix when she hits the lower notes. Apparently, that means everyone thinks she's something else, but she's not. She's a mezzo-soprano, and there we have it. She has a little boy. She married, of course, Simon Konecki, and that was mid-2011. But they got married secretly and no one knew. And the only reason they knew that they were married is suddenly they appeared with rings on. And everyone went, you know, obviously the press went, hang on, they've got rings on. We missed the wedding and were furious about that. And they just went off and did it privately with their mates and no one ever knew. And they also, when their child was young and in a pram, a little boy, they went out on a family day out, and some of the British tabloids posted pictures of it, and they sued and they won, because they said they didn't want their son's picture in the papers. And she's always been quite avid about that. She didn't want her kid growing up with everyone knowing what he looks like and in the public eye. She doesn't want to do that. Anyway, they sued and they won. Wonderful. Let's talk about the song that I'm choosing to represent Adele. Let's be honest, there's about 10 that I could have played. We could do 14 albums and still not be done. But let's do Someone Like You. It was recorded and aided by Dan Wilson for her second studio album. It was 2011. It's the second single, final track on the album, and inspired by a broken relationship. The lyrics obviously speak about Adele's coming to terms with it. And, you know, she sings from the heart. She sings from feeling. It went everywhere. Global success, reaching number one in 19 countries, top 10 in more, well received everywhere. And then the awards started coming in. And I think that in terms of songs, this defines her. Everybody knows it. Everyone's covered it. Everyone wants to cover it. Everyone continues to cover it. Absolutely amazing and a beautiful music video as well. So let's enjoy this incredible lady.
Yellow Home.
Big
house at 6:40 on this fine Monday afternoon. Hope it's all lovely out there. Good luck with your drive home.
We're gonna get controversial. Just saying.
You think it's controversial?
For me, yes.
Handbags, guys. Handbags. Now don't switch off.
Yeah.
Men everywhere going, oh, kill me now. So, Louis Vuitton, as it's supposed to be pronounced.
Louis Vuittons.
Louis Vuitton.
Oh.
Has launched a special on-the-go bag. I don't know what that means. Anyway, it's a resort bag, and it's exclusively for this region. It's retailing at quite a hefty price. Let me just describe the bag
first. Please
do. Okay.
For us very confused people out there, please describe. I'm very confused. I'm looking at it. I don't know.
It's beautiful. It is actually a thing of gorgeousness.
Okay.
So, I mean, some Louis Vuitton I wouldn't touch. I wouldn't touch if you paid me to wear it. I would not go near it. But this is super fun.
Wow.
So it's kind of pink and yellow, girls. It's got that kind of holiday vibe. It says the UAE in pink on the side of it. And it has got, you know, their emblem, which is
the
L and the V, the logo.
Yeah.
But also those little emblems around them. We all know the kind of design. Well, they've shaken it up, and so that's in white, but in large kind of imagery on the bag. And then it's got a canvas kind of basket weave down the side panels, and the top straps are kind of a nude leather. Like, it's really nicely done. So you've got pink and yellows pastels with UAE written in pink, and then the basket bits down the side holding it all together. It's a cute thing. You can imagine sort of beach towel, bikini, sun cream, let's go. That would be all in that beautiful bag. It would be lovely. Now, the price of this beautiful, lovely resort holiday bag, which is probably the size of kind of a Mac computer, like a laptop. So what? I know there's different sizes.
The
right?
way you put it,
I suddenly realised what I'd said. A sort of a laptop size.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No. I mean, yeah.
I'm just, because it could be small. Girls will be going, well, how big are we talking? Not that it matters.
So how? What's the size of this? Is medium? Small, like, does it say?
I've seen it against models of people.
Like,
so
show me.
Look, it's the size of this computer. Size of a laptop.
Okay.
Well, but you could fit more than a laptop in it. Like, it's a small kind of clutch handle. It's not a long handle. Girls, it's a nice. He's so bored. He's now dancing to his own YouTube cameras. All right, so, oi. Guess how much the bag is.
I have a lot of things to say. Yeah, how much the bag?
Okay, the bag is 12,500 dirhams. It's lovely though. It's lovely. And did I have that money, I would so consider it.
See, this is why I love the show. It's like, I get bored when I'm on my own, of course, Anna, when you're giving me, you know, these things.
Grief.
But, I don't know. But, okay, let's talk about it.
Okay, let's talk about it.
Beautiful bag, right? Beautiful bag, says the UAE.
Like,
okay, cool, beach vibe and
super
stuff like that.
Super fun, yeah.
Okay, can we agree on a couple of things, though?
Mm-hmm.
The bag is not cheap.
No.
Fact, right?
Fact,
great.
Yeah.
Does it look good? Yes.
Yeah.
Great. Now, is it worth having?
Yeah.
This is my. I'm sure if you're talking to somebody else, who you know that will agree with it, like, yeah, of course. I'm just saying. What, talk to me. Why do you think this is valuable in your wardrobe?
Look, I am a handbag girl. I'm a handbag girl. Yeah.
Not
and
shoes.
And shoes. Yeah. I love them.
Shoes or handbag?
But I'm currently sporting, you know, bloody Adidas Originals. Look, I love a shoe. I love a handbag.
Mm.
I've got some properly beautiful handbags in my wardrobe that don't see enough air, to be honest.
Okay, okay.
Because you've got to go to the right place to,
yes,
to swing a properly gorgeous bag.
I like
got
that.
Some beautiful ones.
I like the use of words, to swing properly. It's like, you know, a big deal when a handbag, yeah, that hasn't seen the light comes out of the closet.
Oh, it's angels sing. There'll be moments, and I'm sure there'll be some girls who absolutely get what I'm saying, and, yeah, then there'll be other women going, what is wrong with you? I wear,
really,
flip-flops. Yeah, some women are not into, okay, it. But I do love a bag. And there've been times in my life where I've had the money to go, I'm having that. Or a gentleman has bought one for me, which is even more fun.
$3,403, like for a bag,
yeah,
right? I'm just thinking, again, no judging, it's just, yeah.
I understand the judgment.
No, I don't judge, only God can judge. But I'm just saying, it's just, I don't know. $3,400 for a bag.
But the loveliness of knowing that you have that bag, and that when you have it, there's a loveliness to have it. If someone else comes up and says, is that the blah, blah, blah bag? And you go, yeah.
Yeah, now
there's a mutual love there.
What's going to happen is, like, they're going to make replicas of this one, and they're going to sell it for $10 somewhere.
Yeah. It'll be happening. And this region's great for that.
Everywhere, really.
Like, a couple of times. Yeah, no, you're right. But there's a couple of times I did go and get some copies of bags. They do not come out of my wardrobe.
Really?
I don't like the feeling, okay, that I'm faking it. I'd rather not try.
You'd rather get the real thing.
Yeah, because I went to look for a Victoria Beckham bag at a place where I knew they did kind of good copies, and I was there going, it looks beautiful. You would never know.
Really?
But I know that it's not real.
You would never know.
You'd never know.
Oh, wow.
Oh, no.
That's tricky for us.
Some of them are actually from the factory. I mean, some of them are off the back of a lorry. Maybe they're firsts that weren't quite right.
Got you.
So they are from the factory. It's just that I know. So I can't swing it with pride, because if someone says, that's a nice bag, I want to go, yeah, actually, it's a fake one. Like, I've got Tourette's in terms of, have to tell the truth. So I'm not the girl for that. So if you see me with a nice bag, you'll know that it's authentic, because I can't do fake. But yeah,
12,000 dirham, ladies and gentlemen, for this pink bag called Louis Vuitton.
Pink and yellow,
and has, yeah, I don't know. I think for me it's a matter of perception. Again, no judgment, you know, do you, more power to you, cool. Yeah. I'm just thinking that it's a matter of a principle for me.
Yeah,
like
even
if you shift to electronics, which is something I love, right? Like,
yeah,
just shift that. It's hard for me to buy something like, like that. There's a price range for me of where to go, you know?
Yeah, and then you ethically stop and go, I'm not willing to do that anymore.
Yeah, because if you don't have that, then you can buy anything, really. Like, it doesn't really matter. If you can afford it, you can buy it.
Yeah.
But for me, even if I can, like, even if I have $1 trillion in my bank account right now,
right,
which I really hope, I wouldn't buy something that, like, for example, a phone that's worth $5,000. I wouldn't buy that.
Okay.
But yeah, that's personal
opinion.
Remember
that it puts money back into the economy. I actually heard some rich people talking about this. No, I did. And I was thinking, this is really interesting. They said, look, it's fine having a go at me, but actually, if I don't continue to take my wealth and spend it, it doesn't go back in. It doesn't keep the circle going. And we have to remember that.
I could write a thesis about what you just said, but I don't want to play the Peter Gabriel track.
Yeah, but all right, we all sit on our millions, and you just.
I'm not saying sit. Like, you could invest that, you can help people. Like,
oh,
let's
not
go there.
Look, morally, you're completely right. I haven't got a leg to stand on. But I do think, in terms of turnover, look, no one's buying flights. No one's going on holiday. Hotels are suffering. Airplanes are suffering. Everyone's losing their jobs. Think about the steps in the chain, and, you know,
I think it's a personal decision as well. Like, you buy it, you buy it.
Right.
Done. Like, you have a point. I'm just, you know.
Yellow Home with Ella Scofield and Big House.
7:03. Tonight's gone so quick. Let's talk about the weekend, because we all love working towards the weekend, and tomorrow's hump day. Saturday evening, 6 till 7, Big House has his own party show. You better be part of it. We have some amazing prizes for you to win.
Yeah, basically, it's going to be the same sponsors as last week, you guys. And, you know, I believe this could be the last one before the blessed month of Ramadan. And we're going heavy. We're going to give you a one-night stay courtesy of Sheraton Sharjah Beach Resort and Spa. This whole experience is worth 1,500 dirhams. It's for two people, including breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It's fantastic, incredible hotel, Sheraton Sharjah Beach Resort and Spa. And they are offering this one-night stay. They have their own private beach. They got two outdoor infinity pools.
Wow.
They got a kids club and pool. Go there and enjoy a nice staycation right here at the heart of Sharjah, and of course at Sheraton. Yani, what more do you want? It's beautiful, beautiful. And all you got to do is really tune in 6 p.m. on Saturday. Like I said, the room is worth 1,500 dirham a night, but we're giving it to you for free. And our second sponsor, we got G-Shock in the building. And these guys have been personally with me for the past 10 years, always showing love, always supportive. The watch is just heavy duty, really. You know, very, very tough. Real diverse, and most importantly, what's amazing about G-Shock is the fact that they also show a lot of love to the community and you know, to artists, and they always try to be at every release, at every event, which is just really remarkable. So yeah. 6 to 7 p.m. on Saturday, it's been really incredible, and like I said, it could be the last Saturday vibe just before we see Ramadan, because obviously in Ramadan Saturday Vibe is gonna take a break, and then we'll be back after Ramadan with bigger and more and more bigger surprises and sponsors. But this Saturday, 6 to 7 p.m. Anna, you gotta tune in.
Cold.
She's been always tuning in. 10 seconds before the news, but yeah. I have a lot to say about Tazaz, you know? But yeah, approaching the 7 p.m. headlines, please watch us on YouTube. We will be right back.
Yalla home. And Big House.
Hey, Pulse 95. Tell you what, Will Smith, move over. And it's Schofield, Big House, we taking over. You ready?
Go on, keep going. Living it.
Oh, man. Don't you just like Will Smith, generally? Like, I think he, Oh, no, you're not a fan of Will Smith.
I am.
Okay. Because I saw the pause right there.
Yeah, I sort of, you know, got a bit bored of all the Men in Blacks, the kind of comedy performance. I've seen the performance before. I think he's a really good actor.
Okay.
But this kind of, I'm a really funny guy, kind of doing this. I've seen it quite a few times.
Okay, interesting.
So, yeah.
I think as a rapper, he has this old school vibe to him, and he was...
Yeah.
He's definitely one of my favorite rappers. Like, you know, back in the day, he was really cool. But right now, let's talk about this South Korean couple who actually vandalized a painting worth $500,000 by mistake.
Yeah, and so here's how it went down. Mm. Let me break it down.
The
artist is called John Wan. And it's an American graffiti artist. He is an American graffiti artist. And the painting is over 2 meters long and 700 centimeters tall. So it's 240 wide by 700 tall. So it's a really big thing. And obviously valued at $500,000. So it was done in a certain part of the world. And it took a long time to do. And he's a famous artist. Anyway, this painting has been traveling the world. And with the painting goes the paint pots at the front that he did it with. And the paint pots travel with it. And that's the kind of the feature.
Come on.
Right. So
they thought they were allowed to do that.
They walk up, they see the paint pots, they see the brushes. And you see them on CCTV. They've got CCTV footage of it. This couple suddenly step forward and they decide that they'll have a go. They thought it was community artwork. That's what they said. They get out the black paint. Not even a colour. The black. They go for the black and go, yeah, I think it needs a bit of black. Right here in the middle. And they both have a go. And they both splodge black paint all over it. And then they admire their work and off they walk. And they have just defaced a $500,000 painting that has been doing a tour of the world in various galleries. It's a really famous painting. The authorities are
I'm actually looking at the CCTV. Like, this is crazy. But come on, like, look, if you... Yeah.
I know, right? There's no sign saying...
There's no sign.
Come on, welcome.
For me,
yourself.
I don't know. I'm looking at it right now. It looks like everybody, like, you know, it's art. I know it's art. I get it. But, like, look at it.
They just rock up and they do it. They're having a go.
Oh, my God. Yeah. They thought it's just... The thing is, look, to be honest, I don't blame the couple. And I don't know if this is some sort of internal thing. There should be a security guard standing there. Or there should be a sign saying, don't touch. You know when you go to art galleries, respectable art galleries, you don't sit, don't touch, please don't do it. Like, even when you go to a car, you know.
But there's no sign inviting them to take part either.
Yeah, but again, it's art, right? Like, so maybe they're very artistic and they want to express themselves. Because then art is expressing, no?
I suppose so.
Like, I keep looking at it. And I don't know till when, actually, the security comes in. And they, see, this is... The black one, like you said, the black paint is the vandalism. But other than that, you feel like everybody's really also doing it.
No,
fam, come on. Art is subjective, I get it.
But
go to the regular Joe right now. Go to the regular. This is art for you.
I love it. I love that kind
of
art.
I get it.
Yeah.
I'm not against it, but I'm just saying, if you don't know nothing about art,
I'm a Pollock girl.
And you go in and you figure out, like, you know, it looks like everybody, like, seriously,
look,
see?
It's I know what you're saying. So
it's abstract art,
abstract
obviously,
art.
And it's just,
so
you know,
it's open to interpretation.
Very unfortunate, yeah. But like, I really don't really blame the couple as much as I blame the place, to be honest. Like, I don't know what, and I don't know if there's something internal, like if there's a hidden story that we don't know about.
No, I think, but I don't think they expected anyone to draw on the painting or to try and have a go themselves, because actually these pots had gone with the painting. So it was quite a famous sort of...
See? So they didn't know about it.
They obviously
like you're saying, these go with the painting. So maybe he did the painting with these. Okay, great. So there should be a note. I don't know if there's a note
saying a story,
you know.
You're right.
The CCTV footage showed the couple using these, you know, paint and brush, and, you know, they confessed that they thought they were allowed to do that as part of the, you know, participation thing, and made a mistake. We are in a discussion with the artist. This is to decide what to do. Now, okay, my question to you, Anna, if you were the artist, seriously, because I have something I want to say.
All right.
If I was the artist, but if you were the artist, what would you do?
I probably would laugh.
$500,000.
Yeah, I think it will be worth more now. It's just gone up, I reckon, because this couple have come along and added their black streaks, and now it's made the news. This will be like one of those things where it's probably worth even more, because it's that unique painting where a couple walked up and decided to add their bit.
It's interesting that you say that, because one of the visitors of this gallery said, after seeing the news report that this had happened, they didn't know about it before, but they saw it.
Yeah.
And they're like, I was curious, so I came earlier than planned.
Right.
Right? And you know, obviously, damaging the artwork is a serious wrongdoing, and she thinks that it should be restored.
Right. Take the.
But it was curious for her to come down before than planned.
Yeah.
If I was the artist, I think I would definitely embrace the couple and say,
thank you for taking part.
That, something like that, you know, and actually give. I mean, again, I would embrace the couple for taking a step to express themselves. Because art, for me, if I'm an artist, I'm expressing, it's all about expressing yourself.
Yeah.
If you look at what he did, the graffiti artist or the artist, it's also very abstract, very expressive. You don't know. You need to sit down with the artist. It's not like somebody sitting down watching birds. It's like you don't know what's with that. It's very abstract.
Yeah.
I think it's like expressing yourself like that is one of the most beautiful things. And I know it's really weird, but I don't know. I'm just really curious right now, what is he gonna say? Is he really gonna charge them?
Yeah.
Is he gonna make them pay $500,000? A couple, like, probably, you know, they can't afford that.
No, they won't be able to afford it. Definitely not. No, it's one of those things that I think is just everyone's sort of shrugging, going, okay, well, this happened. And there it is. I'm sure it's, I mean, yeah, it is what it is. But it's quite funny. You walk up and you just think, oh yeah, we'll add some.
It's Yalla Home. Yalla Home. With Anna Schofield
and Big Hass.
95 Radio, Yalla Home. Big Hass and Anna Schofield. We are taking over your radio. Okay, couple of things right here. I'm just a quick public service announcement right here.
Right.
So basically, this is concerning Sharjah. COVID PCR test must for students as Sharjah schools are ready to open. Private schools and students in Sharjah can return to campus, obviously, April 11th. That's what authorities have actually announced. So in-person classes at public school will resume from April 18th, according to the Sharjah Emergency Crisis and Disaster Management Team. Now, students need to present a COVID negative result of a PCR test taken no more than 72 hours before going to school.
How old?
Like, I don't know what are the ages of the students coming in right now. What is, like, I don't know.
I think it's 12 and over for a PCR test.
I have no idea, really. Yeah. I've never really... I don't know how I feel about kids and PCR tests. Do they do the same thing?
They have to do the whole thing. Oh, no. Sorry, 12 and over, I think, is what they are thinking about for vaccinations. For COVID tests, yeah, kids can have them.
Yeah, so apparently, if you're going to school, PCR tests are a must.
Right.
And,
okay.
Yeah, we, you know... It's just, yeah, man, this kids generation, this era, or the kids right now, yeah, I think they've experienced some of their, you know, like with last year, and some people test, no test, some people were going to college, that was put on hold, and everything got really tangled up, and
yeah.
I understand, but this is all part of, you know, obviously their plan, whatever is destined to happen to them, it's all part of it, that's what I believe, but yeah. Apparently, you need a PCR test then.
Okay.
If you liked this episode of Yalla Home, drop a like and subscribe.
95.
Be sure to follow us on Instagram for all our daily updates and top stories.